It's better than sex. It reaches such a climax that I feel like I'm reaching one.
Nina Simone is remembered as an artist, a virtuoso, and an innovator. But perhaps what most comes to mind when hearing her describe the works of Johann Sebastian Bach with such memorable intensity and vigor is her unflinching refusal to limit herself to any one genre or style of music.
Really, it is. When I hear it now, oh my God, it's too much.
Simone, a world-renowned pianist, vocalist, and songwriter, is best known for her musical compositions and reworkings that gave voice to great passion and scored great social change. Her work showcased deep and sincere emotions of intimate love, operatic melancholy, and towering immortal endurance. Her music, and indeed her life, grew throughout her career to be deeply entwined with her personal activism. In songs such as Four Women, Mississippi Goddam, and Funkier Than a Mosquito's Tweeter, Nina fought loudly and intersectionally for feminism and civil rights. Not only did she challenge the social values of her time, Simone also continues to defy classification due to her vast range of influences, which came together to form a unique and often varied discography. In Nadine Cohodes' book, Princess Noir: The Tumultuous Reign of Nina Simone, she highlights this range when discussing Simone's beginnings in playing live in clubs. Of her late 50s performances at the Midtown in Atlantic City, she writes,
quote, "Nina's sets evolved into a merry-go-round of styles and genres that was rarely the same on any given night. Folk songs, show tunes, hits, and some that should have been hits, along with her own creations, which were sometimes extended piano compositions she played that first week in the Midtown."
It's worth noting here that from early in her career, Simone's performances and writing were already the sum of a multitude of musical parts.
Simone's work, like that of any innovator, means a lot of different things to a lot of different people. When setting off to research academic writing around the subject, one will quickly realize that no one seems to have been able to put her satisfyingly into any one musical genre. People most widely recognize her as a jazz singer, and yet when discussing her canon, the frequent mentions of blues, gospel, folk, show tunes, and classical music shows both the plethora of her musical interests and the inherent failings of categorizing Simone's work and practice into one neatly labeled box. In her 2017 journal article, I Don't Trust You Anymore: Nina Simone, Culture and Black Activism in the 1960s, Ruth Feldstein exposes a key issue with scholarship regarding Nina. She expresses how,
quote, "Many critics from around the world concluded that she was the best singer of jazz of these last years, and that she had a particularly extraordinary presence in live performances and a magical ability to connect to her audiences. Nevertheless, beyond brief references to Mississippi Goddam, she has largely fallen through the cracks of scholarship, on music, on civil rights, and on women's activism. Jazz scholars, for instance, have produced a trajectory from swing to bebop to free jazz within which Simone does not neatly fit. Scholars of the civil rights movement who are interested in untraditional leaders, including women, have tended to focus on rural or rank-and-file women."
She continues,
"Her absence emerges from the ways that certain kinds of cultural productions and particular expressions of female sexuality have often been placed beyond the parameters of African American political history."
As we can interpret from the source, Nina's legacy has been impacted by what has been deemed by academia significant to remember of a black female artist.
As you can see, people are quick to put Simone in a box, even if she doesn't fit neatly into our modern understanding of genre. Categorizing artists is not necessarily unethical. However, in this case, it is worth noting that these reductions of an inherently multifaceted body of work is an act of dismissive shorthand, not often forced onto the other, often white, often male, quote-unquote great figureheads of indeed any of the spheres Simone occupies, be that Joni Mitchell or John Coltrane, Dylan or Bach, all of whom's varied and popular discographies are often discussed with kind of nuance.
Along with us continuing to draw attention to this need to awkwardly compartmentalize Simone's music, today we will also be exploring her legacy in a more progressive and practical way. To most vividly showcase the heterogeneity of styles scattered across the corners of the map of Nina's discography and highlight her broad range of forms mastered, we have attempted to bring these different aesthetics and techniques into one performance.
First, we'd like to show you our outcome, then explain our methodology. Here is our arrangement, performance, and recording of our interpretation of the songs I Wish I Knew How It'd Feel to Be Free and Funkier Than a Mosquito's Tweeter.
Thank you.
Thank you for listening. While we will never hold a candle to the creative titan herself, our aim with this recording was not to compete with her work, but to celebrate it and include as much of Simone's musical vocabulary in one performance as possible, without devaluing the music on a level of parody or gimmick. Here's how we got from that concept to the finished project, in rationale and process.
One of the key decisions early on was to make this work instrumental. Neither of us are singers in the same idiom as Simone, and while selecting a vocalist would have been possible, we are aiming to demonstrate the range of her aesthetic musicality specifically. Breaking down the themes of her writing beyond what we have covered so far, while undeniably worthwhile, might not fit the constraints of this project. This was a decision that benefited us when it came to arranging, as we had more freedom to interpret Simone's melodies through different techniques stylistically consistent with the sounds we were emulating at any given moment.
Once we had decided on an instrumental arrangement, we knew that keys would have to be present. Simone's writing and improvisation through her piano playing was in many ways a second voice. In Malik Gaines' book, Black Performance on the Outskirts of the Left, A History of the Impossible, he writes,
quote, Simone's piano's voice, founded in the inverted church of the Black Mother, shaped by the rigors of male German composers and professionalized through the American songbook, is also transvocal.
Clearly, it would be remiss to not include such an immensely integral part of her artistic output. In this case, piano and organ playing were supplied by UOB computer science student and immensely talented musician, Jakub Balic. Trying to keep things stripped down for the sake of making our point as clear as possible, Christoph decided to play drums and control the main rhythmic aspect, and I opted to also play my main instrument, guitar, to serve as the main harmonic drive to trade with the keys. Along with this, I added some bass in the outro of the funkier section.
Speaking of, for our pieces we chose, I Wish I Knew How It'd Feel to Be Free for its relatively repetitive structure and excessively pop-adjacent feel. This beautiful work in its familiarity and openness lended us a kind of stylistic blank canvas, which made our point easier to get across. Initially, we had planned to just perform this tune, but we decided to add, as an outro of sorts, a version of Funkier Than a Mosquito's Tweeter to explore the edgier, looser, and more aggressive sounds that Nina's work covered. A work of that nature also gave us the opportunity to imitate different instrumentation and employ a different guitar tone to suit her vocal performance on this track.
In terms of our arrangement, as you heard, we started by playing the song relatively as is, with guitar and then keys imitating the vocal and setting the precedent for trading interpretations of the main melody throughout our rendition. Our first departure from this was the shuffle. Simone has made at least two blues albums, more depending on your classification, with influences from Jimmy Reed to Ma Rainey, so we opted for a classic Chicago shuffle, seen in the alternate version of her original song, Do I Move You, with blues embellishment throughout the guitar melody. Do I move you? Then, trading back to piano, a jazz ballad felt to be a suitable pairing. We made an effort to convey looseness here, evocative of the freedom of recordings such as Under the Lowest, and elaborated chordally and harmonically, leaning on more complicated voicings and including lots of seventh and nine chords. Where we had used chromatic parting tones in the bluesy shuffle section, now we were leaning harder on those moments of dissonance. Then we gave space for a free-time classical music-inspired moment. There is precedent here for this kind of break in Simone's work. Listen and see if you can hear the transition into a similar passage in this performance of Love Me or Leave Me, live on the Ed Sullivan Show in 1960. No more tomorrow, have it today to give back tomorrow. Your love is my love, there's no love for nobody else.
We didn't quite do it as good as Simone. No one can, but hopefully our attempt was clear. Coming out of this section, we modulated a half step up, both to build momentum and to keep the ear alive. This modulation takes us into, and is a relatively common hallmark of our next style, Motown. This section was greatly inspired by energetic and intricately arranged Motown recordings, such as Marvin Gaye and Tammy Terrell's Ain't No Mountain High Enough. This is a style not often talked about in the same breath as Simone. However, we certainly hear decidedly Motown flares in the arrangement and feel of tracks such as I Ain't Got No, I Got Life and Cinnamon, the latter of which coexist beautifully with the strong traditional African influence. We try to play busy yet melodic lines. Jesse's guitar part here is full of pentatonic trills and soul-inspired cliche phrases which move in thirds and sixths. Then, the outro, funkier than a mosquito's tweeter, had elements of course, the original track, but also artists with similarly dynamic performance styles. In voicing this intense, gritty melody for guitar, we took some inspiration from Hendrix, whose live performances from a similar era were an impact on Simone, who calls him in her autobiography, a great man. Another artist she praised in her autobiography is James Brown, and we also took aesthetic cues from the definitively funky and period correct James Brown Band instrumental album, The Popcorn, for our arrangement.
Here is a somewhat brief overview of how we got from that concept and arrangement to the finished project. We recorded this arrangement piece by piece for maximum control over the sonic palette of our outcome. For the drums, we chose a simple but clear setup, reminiscent of 70s popular recording techniques. We used two AKG C414 condenser microphones, which we're talking into now, one for a mono overhead and a second outside our kick resonant head. We used a pair of SM57 microphones set close above and below our snare for a classic, snappy, responsive tone. Our final mic in this setup was a solitary AKG D112, nestled deep inside the bass drum, near the batter head for a balance of attack and tone, which we adjusted by ear in the studio. We ended up using the audio track from our talkback mic, as it had a surprisingly effective room sound as well. We ran these, and subsequently the DI keys, through the relatively clean and transparent Audion ASP 800 preamp. We made sure the signals were clear, and at a practical gain level, and set about capturing a great performance. Then, for guitar, we settled on an equally simple yet effective close mic on my tube amp with an SM57. Unfortunately, I wasn't happy with this tone, as I found the tone of my amp to be relatively mid-heavy and inflexible. So, I took the direct signal and re-amped it through a software emulation of a classic black panel Fender circuit. This allowed me to tweak the EQ and character of the sound throughout the recording. Doing this for both bass and guitar, starting from the driest possible sound, also made it easier to try and match the room sound of Christoph's drum track. For the final outro section, I also used a simulated fuzz pedal to emulate some of the grit of Simone's vocal on Funkier, and really draw out some of that Hendrix comparison.
Then we set about adding elements of subtle digitally emulated tape saturation, reverbs and delays, and careful small adjustments as we carved out a basic emulated auditory space, which then shifted as necessary so as to minimalize the potential jolt of the stylistic transitions. Hopefully our rationale is clear now, and if you'd like to listen again with added context, we have included a separate file in our submitted materials for you to enjoy at your leisure.
As we come to our conclusion, we feel it worthwhile to note that during our research for this project, much of the scholarship we encountered and ended up including to highlight progressive views of Nina Simone's catalogue are more often than not written by women. The contributions of female scholars to Simone's legacy, like those of Simone herself, can sometimes be marginalised or under-recognised. Despite this, the fact that so much of this definitive literature is written by women shows perhaps a somewhat noticeable element of apathy from some male academics. Therefore, it is especially important in this case for all scholars to remember that any artist in their work is necessarily multifaceted. We cannot let the contributions of those who defy designation slip through the cracks of classification. While there is absolutely a place for focusing on the individual niches seen in Simone's catalogue, it is equally important to remember to look at her as a whole person, especially as this can be a frequent scholarly oversight when it comes to female composers and artists, especially women of colour.
Speaking of the political awakening she had received from author and personal friend Lorraine Hansberry, Simone said, "I started thinking about myself as a black person in a country run by white people and a woman in a world run by men." We posit that it could be that Simone's catalogue is seen to be less adherent to designation, less coherently discussed even, than perhaps some of her white male contemporaries such as Dylan or Sinatra, because the very way the West has come to examine artistic legacy has been oriented around the idea of great white masculine figureheads for so long.
Nina Simone is survived by her legacy, a legacy much debated but undoubtedly one of great artistry. It is of the utmost importance that we hold it up to the light so that it may continue to inspire and enrich the lives of generations to come. Thank you for listening.
Maybe you understand me now. If sometimes you see that I'm mad, don't you know no one alive can always be an angel? When everything goes wrong, you see some bad. But I'm just a soul whose intentions are good.